Today I'm replacing an old ST2000 Raymarine tiller pilot on my Pearson Triton sailboat with a Pelagic Autopilot. I've had earlier ST2000s break down on me, and this one I've been babying it along, using it only for motoring or very light airs when the wind vane can't steer the boat well. It's back there. The Pelagic, similar in concept to the Raymarine Evo 100, which is a more heavy-duty autopilot than the ST2000. But this Pelagic is much less expensive and less parts and should be more powerful and have more fine-tuning adjustments. And some of the features they highlight in the manual are options for tiller or wheel steering, no external compass needed or rudder sensor, and the internal gyro and compass, ability to follow the wind direction through NEMA 0183, an optional remote control that uses low power of less than 0.1 amp in standby, and has adaptive adjustments for sea state and user calibration, and has options for connecting to the wind vane directly. The standard kit comes with the control head here and the cable to connect it, and the motor drive box here, and the tiller actuator with its mounting bracket and plug, as well as the socket for the electrical, the actuator's mounting socket, tiller pin mount, and a cap. I also ordered these optional extras. This is a complete spare tiller actuator. The only thing you have to do is remove the pin to the mounting bracket here on the old one and swap it out, and then take the old plug off and wire it up there. And also got a remote control and actuator cover and a control head cover, sun cover. I didn't get a paper installation manual, but they do have this very good manual online as a PDF, so you can download that. You can mount this control head on the cockpit bulkhead facing aft, either here or over here. I'm going to mount mine here because it's away from the compass. Although I do have a depth sounder here and a GPS plotter on a ram mount that swings out here, and you're not supposed to mount it close to other instruments in case there's some interference with the compass. But in practice, I don't think it's going to matter, so we'll find out when we test it, and we can always move it later. Otherwise, you can order a forward-facing display to mount somewhere in the aft end of the cockpit there, or some people have put it on a strap mount back here in the push pit rail. But back here, it's more vulnerable to getting more sun and water damage, and down here you could kick it or step on it, and you'd have back there you'd have cables running somewhere. You have to figure that out. Now, a good point about forward facing, they say, is that, well, you can see the digital lights coming on as you use the remote course control to confirm what's going on, but I think you can also see it easily this way. You just have to get used to where you're going to look at it from. And at least here it's sheltered by the Dodger and Bimini, and you can reach it without using the remote just by leaning out the companionway hatch. If you're replacing a Raymarine tiller pilot with the Pelagic, it has the same 3/8 mounting pin and socket. and it uses the same tiller pin. So you can keep the tiller pin in there. They do supply a new one if you don't have one. And it mounts in the same location here on the tiller, 18 inches recommended above the rudder axis. And if you've got a light, smaller boat, you could probably shorten that if you needed to, down to 16 inches or whatever. And if you've got a big heavy rudder, like on a West Sail 32, you might want to sacrifice some of the travel for having better leverage and move it further forward a couple inches. But I think 18 inches is pretty safe for most boats. And the Raymarine has a mounting distance from the tiller pin when the tiller is centered to the socket of 23.2 inches, but the Pelagic is 24 and a half inches about, and so I've marked where I need to put a socket further outboard. So they supply you with the socket and the pin in case you need to move them, and they also have different mounting options if you wanted to mount it on the combing or somewhere else. You can have different attachments. The electric plug on the Raymarine is 6-pin, but on the Pelagic, even though it's the same type of connector, it's a 3-pin. And so you'll have to replace that socket with the one they supply you with. And I guess the reason it had 6 pins before is because this is a self-contained tiller pilot, and any NEMA inputs would have to come through those extra pins. And on this unit, you only need 2 wires for power supply. You'll have to extend the green and yellow wires that come out of the motor box, depending how long on where you mount it, to reach the socket. And I've got, instead of yellow and green, I do have a red and yellow duplex that I extended it with. So we'll keep the yellow the same, which goes to the connector pin labeled N. And the green, now the red, is going to the connector labeled L. Drilled that out with a half-inch drill bit, and now we'll mix a bit of epoxy to seat it in with. There's a thickened epoxy around the new socket. The nut on the back of the control head requires drilling a 1¼-inch hole through the coach rift bulkhead. To mount the controller, there's a couple of screw holes inside of these covers. You can just pop them open. And the easiest way to get these screws through here, because it's a deep reach, is to tape them on to the Phillips head screwdriver. This 20-foot long control cable has to pass through the bulkhead, so I'm going to just cut the cable and then splice it together inside here next to the motor control box, and I'll either use crimp connectors or a terminal strip. I've used butyl tape to seal the back of the control box, but you could also use silicone sealant. After cutting that cable to make it easier to run through the lockers, I found there were 8 conductors inside. And not knowing how many of them they're actually using, I reconnected all of them to that terminal block there. And the other wiring was just the 4 wires, 2 for the power to this box. The black one went to the negative bus bar, and the red one went to the switch panel circuit breaker, and the other 2 went to the tiller actuator, And the other bundle of small wires was the NEMA wires for wind, but I'm not connecting those, not using that feature. I ended up reversing the mount and putting the motor facing up, and I found there was just a little bit of looseness in the socket. And so to stop it from rattling a little bit when it's in there, I took a center punch and just peened the top edge in three spots, and that tightened it right up. When you power it up, you get a quick flashing red light over here in standby mode. And if you want to go to auto, you just push auto there. Now, if you want to adjust the gain, which is the responsiveness or how much tiller control, you hold down the port for more than 2 seconds until it flashes. Then you see where the gain is set there. It's now on 3. If you increase the gain, you push the green button. That's 3.5. That's 4. That's maximum. Red to go down. That's 3. That's 2.5. 2, that would be for a boat that's easy to steer in easy conditions. And I think the default was about 3. So I'm going to put it there. And then to lock the gain in, you push the auto. And now it's still in standby. But to turn it on, you just push auto. And it'll start working. And it shows you what gain you have set when the autopilot's on. Motor sailing now with the gain on 1. See, there's one green LED there. The current draw is averaging about 1 amp. It's going from 1/2 to 1.5. In the unlikely event that you need to update the software, it's done through this control head by removing these 6 small Phillips head screws. And then inside, the instructions will show you here how to access the USB connector. It's a USB mini, I think it's a mini B, and that goes into that board fitting there, and then there's a reset button there. And this loose wire you find in here, one end that's loose, that's just the remote control antenna. So that's okay as it is. And if you have a problem with it and they think it's a software issue or an update could fix it, then they'll email you the files and you can then load them from your PC direct into here without it being plugged in. This is the spare tiller actuator, and it comes with just a bare wire on the end, and you'll have to swap your plug from the other tiller actuator if you need to put this in. But to save me the trouble of having to swap this out at sea, I bought a spare plug, and I think it cost something around $25. And I'll assemble it ahead of time here so that it's all ready to go. Getting these grommets on the line. And then the cap for the socket has a castellated end, and that fits in as a tool to unscrew and disassemble this plug assembly. And then that comes out like that and that. So that goes on there. And then There's good instructions in the online manual. Shows that when the plug is facing you from the pin side, the front side, there'll be a little plastic bump in the top right there, and the red wire will go to the left side and the black to the right. And these are held down with the small screw. I haven't bothered to calibrate the compass on it, but the manual shows how you can do that by turning the boat slowly in a circle in a calibration mode. It seems to steer fine on all points of sail and all points on the compass without calibrating here. The Pelagic doesn't have the ability to interface with a chart plotter, but I consider that a good thing because that'll keep you out of trouble and keep the autopilot independent of other systems. In case you have a breakdown with your plotter, it's not going to affect the autopilot. Besides the gain adjustment, there are some parameter adjustments that you can change if you know what you're doing. You have to refer to the manual. But on my boat, when I first got the autopilot installed, the default factory settings for these parameters worked as far as the boat would hold a course, but I found that two of them were set a little too high for my particular boat, so I've adjusted the yaw adjustments, and I'll show you how to do that. The way to get into the parameter adjusting is you hold down the auto switch while you turn on the power. Starts flashing lights, and you keep holding the switch until you get a long, short flash pattern on the red. Then you can release it. Now you're into the parameter adjusting mode. Okay, to make the adjustments, you start, there's zero lights indicated, and you hit the green one that gets you to the first light, which is course correction. Second light is yaw suppression. The third is yaw damping. And the fourth is yaw rate of change. And then you can go back. Now if you want to adjust it or check where it's at, once you're in that parameter of that light, you press the auto briefly, and that tells you that that's at the factory default setting of 1.5, because you have one solid light and one blinking light. So that's okay, so we'll push that briefly, and we go to the second light, which is yaw suppression, and that I changed from factory setting of 3 to 2.5, and that made the boat steer with less effort on the tiller actuator. It wasn't running so constantly, and that seemed to be best for my boat. And go to the next one, 3, and that is a factory set of 0, and the next one is 4, and I also changed that one to 2.5, down from the factory setting of 3. And when you're happy with them, you can push and hold auto for 3 seconds until it flashes, and that will save them. And then it reverts to standby mode. We're under sail now in pretty flat water, about 10 to 12 knots of wind, and we've still got the gain set down at 1, pretty low on the gain. And it's holding course fine. As I change course to starboard, you can see the tiller coming over to port. Now it's on its new course and it's coming back. And the remote brings it back to port. So in calm seas, the gain setting down very low is working fine. If you want to change the gain, put it on standby, hold the port for 2 seconds till they flash, and it shows you the gain it's on now. Starboard will increase it. So put it on 2 and then enter to lock it in and put it back on auto. Now it shows that it's in number 2 gain setting. Up here on the bow, I'm going to try the remote. A is to port, B is to starboard. I'll give it some clicks to starboard. You can see the boat turning against the landscape in the back. And then we'll bring it back to port. So, remote works good from the bow. Might be handy to use it from your bunk down below, or up here on the bow if you're navigating through coral. To tack with the autopilot, you can either hold down the port or starboard on the remote or on the control head. So we'll tack to starboard, hold down B. You see the lights flash and the tiller is going way over. Starting to recover. We're going to tack to port, so we'll hold down the A until it tacks. And there's the optional cover, which is good to keep the sun and spray off of it.